Hello everyone, welcome to Task IS. Today we will discuss Unit 8, that is Research Methods in Anthropology. So every year UPSC asked one question from this unit, but journalist students ignore this unit because they feel that they will write some points from their common sense on these topics like research or different methods like observation, case study. But trust me that when you write any answer, after two or three points you will not have any separate point. So it is necessary that you also give equal importance and attention to these topics as well. So these are some of the subtopics that are given: fieldwork tradition in anthropology, distinction between technique, method and methodology, various tools of data collection, for example observation, interview, schedule, etc., analysis, interpretation and presentation of data. From this part, analysis and presentation of data, UPSC has not asked any important question because this is more related with research work, practical research work. Now another thing is PDF of all videos, whether of ethics or anthropology, are given in our Telegram channel, and link of that channel is given in description of videos. So you can enjoy these free materials as well. And please like, share and subscribe Task IS if you are benefited from our inputs. So let's start research in anthropology. So firstly, we will start with introduction, how research is pursued in our discipline. So research implies a search, that is a new thing, or research, that means we are examining into existing situations or existing work of earlier scientists. It means research can be done in a new area or in a already existed area where you will re-examine situations. So it can be conducted by anyone who is interested to explore truth or to inquire into existing things, but manner of investigation will be different for different scholars and especially in different disciplines. Now, scientific research could be defined as a organized and systematic inquiry into physical or socio-cultural phenomena. Here physical as well as socio-cultural, both terms are important in anthropology because anthropology is a holistic discipline, remember that. So this systematic and organized inquiry to discuss physical and socio-cultural phenomena is important to examine earlier existing knowledge as well as to acquire newer knowledge. As anthropology is a holistic discipline, we will discuss man in totality. So we will focus both on physical as well as socio-cultural research in our discipline. But remember that anthropology can't be said that it is only an experimental or a laboratory based science. That means although you are studying biological anthropology, but you can't say that this is only experimental or laboratory based science, because when you will discuss physical features of any individual, you have to focus on actual region as well as associated socio-cultural phenomena. So that's why it is not only laboratory based scientific research, but it is also an observational and field based science. That means you have to actually observe what is happening on field, and this field work is heart and soul of our discipline. That means in anthropology, scientific research can be done in field work only, and this field work is base of our discipline. But traditionally our discipline anthropology is very much limited in its scope because anthropologists focused more on small scale societies and use only specific methods. But today anthropologists have increased their reach in terms of different specific branches of anthropology, starting from physical, biological, linguistic, or archaeological, as well as newer disciplines like applied and action anthropology. So, to fulfill need of different specific branches, now anthropologists are using more diverse methods and techniques for their research. Now they are using very specific tools as well, but focus that here anthropologists are focusing on specific things, that means on minute things, but they are not ignoring complex or integrated base of our discipline. That means they are studying very minute details of biological, physical, or sociocultural phenomena, but they are studying very integrated effect of these disciplines. So now fieldwork tradition in anthropology. So famous anthropologist Margaret Mead, we have discussed about her in anthropological theories part. So according to her, fieldwork is central to inquiry of anthropology, and inquiry is important for growth of any discipline, because till the time you will not ask any question, you will not apply your logic, no scholar or discipline can grow. So according to Margaret Mead, we still have no way to make an anthropologist except by sending him into the field. That means to become an anthropologist, one have to go into field for research work, and this contact with living material is our distinguished mark. So this contact of field work is a distinguished feature of our discipline that makes it separate from other social disciplines, for example economics or sociology, and all these points we have discussed in unit 1 earlier, so you can connect those points. Here Margaret Mead has summarized role of fieldwork in anthropology. Now we will discuss about evolution of fieldwork in our discipline. So what is history? Now we'll discuss. So when anthropologists started its work, so earlier anthropologists were called as armchair anthropologists because they are interested in knowing the world, but they have little interest to go into field and investigate on their own. These 19th century scholars depend on data collected by various missionaries, voyagers, traders, administrators, etc. Because remember, this was time period of colonization, and when different administrators and different colonial rulers established their rule in very backward countries, which Britishers were called. So in these simple societies, these administrators, traders, or missionaries started to provide different kind of data to anthropologists. But remember that these different means of collecting data is based on colonial interest. So questions were raised on business of these missionaries, traders, or administrators in collecting data. Now important anthropologists have role in establishing fieldwork as an important component of our discipline. So most of the armchair anthropologists were classical anthropologists in those times, but some important anthropologists like L.H. Morgan, who was a classical anthropologist but has role in establishing fieldwork in our discipline. L.H. Morgan is known for his studies on family, marriage, and kinship. Although this is not a typical fieldwork, or it not followed detailed description which later Malinowski provided for a good fieldwork, but he has done a initiation point of fieldwork study, and his study on family, marriage, and kinship in Iroquois Indians, that is native of American tribe, is important. And here he has also described about different kind of kinship terminologies, that is क्लासिफिकेटरी और डिस्क्रिप्टिव. सो वी विल डिस्कस इट लेटर, बट यू कैन कनेक्ट दिस डॉट पॉइंट्स दैट हाउ एल एच मॉर्गन फील्ड वर्क हैज़ हेल्प्ड इन प्रोवाइडिंग डिटेल डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ किनशिप टर्मिनोलॉजीज. नाउ अनदर स्कॉलर्स वर ब्रिटिश स्टॉलवर्ट्स, डब्ल्यू एच आर रिवर्स एंड ए सी हेडन. दे हैव ऑर्गेनाइज ए फेमस एक्सपेडिशन टू टोरस स्ट्रेट इन पैसिफिक इन ऑस्ट्रेलिया इन 1898. सो एल एच मॉर्गन हैज़ वर्क इन 1840s, बट दिस एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट हैज़ डन देयर वर्क इन 1898. यू कैन रिमेंबर दीज थिंकर्स नेम सो दैट योर आंसर विल लुक मोर होलिस्टिक. And when you revise these points again and again, these names will be settled in your brain automatically. Now another is Franz Boas, who is called as father of American anthropology. He tried to give some guidance how to do and field work, because he has mentioned that for an anthropologist it is necessary to stay long time with subject to collect a subjective description of that community. Also, it is necessary that anthropologists should collect maximum data and they should not focus on providing their own theory or their own generalization. They should study every society from society's needs, from society's acceptance level, not from biasness or attitude of researcher. So he wants to collect maximum data, and he also tried to counter ethnocentrism by his concept of cultural relativism. Here ethnocentrism shows that earlier armchair anthropologists have attitude that their culture is superior and other colonies has inferior culture, but Boas has given cultural relativism concept where he has mentioned that every culture has its own importance and various attributes or various features of any culture should be studied from its perspectives, from communities' needs, their acceptance level, etc. That means here any anthropologist should not try to impose their cultural values on any society which they are studying, and anthropologists try to avoid giving generalization, because if you are making some theory or giving some generalization, that will be against diversity, and then anthropologists will not be able to study variations in totality. Now Malinowski, he is considered as a father of fieldwork tradition because some rules which were given by Franz Boas were actually implemented by Malinowski, and after his work it is nearly institutionalized in our discipline that fieldwork is mandatory, and long stay and learning native language is also one of important component, and he has led to development of British School of Anthropology. He has done his fieldwork in Trobriander Islands of Papua New Guinea, and he has highlighted that how culture, society and its people were integrated. That means if you want to study society, you have to understand culture of those community, culture of those people, and similarly if you want to understand any individual of that society, you have to gain knowledge about that society, because any factor of that society will have impact on that individual, and how culture will impact an individual is also decided by their interrelations. So you have to understand any society in its totality to understand any specific trait. For example, if you want to understand any socio-cultural phenomena like marriage, then you have to study various cultural dimensions, its evolution, related rules, regulations, type of relations between different individuals, different families, or different partners. So all this you have to study. And Malinowski has mentioned that importance of building rapport with society, staying long for a study, and getting to know the society being studied is equally important for any research work. And he has given elaborate description of Kula Ring in his famous work, that is Argonauts of Western Pacific, when he was doing field work in Papua New Guinea. What is Kula Ring? Kula Ring is ceremonial exchange between different islands of Pacific Ocean, where these islands have ceremonial exchange system. That means they will exchange things, but not for economic value, but their ceremonial, their religious, or their socio-cultural importance. Although nowadays this is also treated as a source for economic transactions, but its main or basic goal is ceremonial exchange. Now, Boas students in South America, famous one are Ruth Benedict, Margaret Mead, and Cora Dubois. These are famous female anthropologists of our discipline and who have done their fieldwork in 1920s or 30s. And due to their efforts, now feminism or sexuality, these topics are discussed in our discipline. So you can say that these anthropologists now bring women related issues in research work of discipline, because earlier, although anthropologists are studying about these women related issues, but if any woman is doing field work and she is giving her hypothesis, then that's become important for any discipline. So these advances in our discipline set the ground for serious fieldwork methodology, and now any individual who wants to pursue in anthropology have to do fieldwork. Now this has become mandatory for every student as well as for every scholar. Now, distinction between technology, method, and methodology. So firstly, these terms are used interchangeably because there is very minute difference in their meaning. Now, what is method? Method is a way of conducting and implementing research, while methodology is science and philosophy behind all that research. That means method is a kind of some tool that you will use, but what kind of method you will use and what will be possible hurdles and possible implications of using that particular method is decided by methodology. That means philosophical or analytical part is methodology, where you will take important decisions how you will proceed in your research work. But method is where you will think about that this particular way of doing thing I will choose. So various examples of method can include case study method, participant observation method. So we have discussed difference between method and methodology. So if UPSC asked about this topic, what you have to do is write basic definition of methodology or method, and then describe two or three lines about every example, like case study or participant observation, so that your examples will look holistic. Now, in general uses, is method is a broader term as compared to technique. So what we have discussed is methodology is broader term than method, and then is technique. So technique is very specific in nature, and every method can use two or three techniques for any research work. For example, case study or participant observation is a method, but in case study you can utilize various techniques, for example interview, observation, or questionnaire. Because in case study, what you will do, you will decide that these are my samples and I will study them. So this is a kind of case study, and you will discuss एनी टॉपिक रिलेटेड क्वेश्चन विद दैम इन डिटेल. बट वट काइंड ऑफ टूल यू विल यूज टू गेन इंफॉर्मेशन फ्रॉम दैट पर्टिकुलर कम्युनिटी, दैट इज टेक्निक. सो फर्स्ट स्टेज इज मेथडोलॉजी वेर यू विल डिसाइडेड दैट आई विल स्टडी ए कम्युनिटी ए एंड आई विल यूज केस स्टडी मेथड. सो नाउ सेकेंड स्टेज इज केस स्टडी मेथड वेर यू हैव डिसाइडेड दैट आई विल यूज केस स्टडी मेथड. दैट मीन्स यू विल स्टडी इन डिटेल अबाउट दैट पर्टिकुलर कम्युनिटी एंड यू कैन टेक एनी सैम्पल और even whole community to study about them. But what kind of different methods? Maybe you can choose to take answers from those people and fill your schedule, or you can interview those questions where no written data will be collected from those people. So these are some of the different techniques to collect data. Although this is a strict difference, but in various books as well as in common terminology, these terms are used interchangeably. So don't confuse with them. So now it is mentioned that if you don't have a well-planned or organized idea, then any technique or any method like interview or case study, anything can't be work properly. So you have to organize your research work. You have to, in early times of your project or your thesis, you have to decide that this will be my next thesis of work. So that will enhance your efficiency and increase objectivity of any research work. So now first is observation. Simply what we mean by observation is simply observing something from our senses. And in social research, this is one of the most important and extensively used method in anthropology. But all observations are not scientific, because any observation becomes scientific only if it is planned and executed systematically. So you can consider that although you observe a lot of things every day, but all are not scientific observation because you don't analyze those points and you don't plan to collect information from those observations. So this observation can be done in real life as well as in laboratory, because in laboratory various disciplines like chemistry or pure biology or physics, they have laboratory based approach and they observe their reactions or their instruments. But anthropology focus on real life setting. An anthropologist will observe individual as well as collective or social behavior in real life setting. And Herskovitz, important anthropologist, he has mentioned that fieldwork as the ethnographer's laboratory, because in fieldwork anthropologists do a lot of tasks. So now what are the preconditions or prerequisites for good observation? Firstly, you have to establish a good rapport and friendly relations that will help you to collect information without resistance from local people. Secondly, if you are paying attention to every minute detail, then you will have a detailed idea of any phenomena you are observing. And you have to record everything what you exactly see. That means you have to reduce your own biasness in collecting data. And you can record your personal impression in your personal diary or fieldwork notes, but you have to mention that what I feel, so that any further scholar or a common man who is studying about any community, they have idea that this is biasness of any researcher, not an objective statement. Now observation is divided mainly in two parts. Firstly, uncontrolled observation. Second is controlled observation. So uncontrolled observation is a form of observation which is done in natural environment. That means there is no controlled or external factor which have influence on natural environment. Now first is participant observation. This is type of uncontrolled observation. So now we are discussing in detail about uncontrolled observation. After that we will discuss about controlled observation. So first is participant observation. When research actively participate in any activities of group which he is studying, this is called as participant observation. So participant, it means that any scholar who is doing work, he have to become a participant of that community. That means that scholar will take participate in all activities of that community so that native people don't feel uncomfortable that they are performing with any unknown individual. But in participant observation, if extreme level of participant observation is followed, then the researcher may forget about his identity and may lose his objectivity in fieldwork. So what are precautions that should be taken for participant observation? Firstly, be sensitive due to situations and social context. For example, if someone is asking about sexual life experiences or about any tragedy like accidents or mishappenings, then he should be sensitive. Secondly, behave in a responsible manner. Otherwise, people will resist in collecting data about them. Now, there should not be any superiority or inferiority complex which earlier anthropologists, specifically armchair anthropologists, have. Now they should not seek any special status because it will destroy purpose of our study. Because if you want any special status, that environment will not be natural, and then participant observation study can't be concluded. Now maintain objectivity irrespective of your close linking with the community members. So you, every time you are participating in any event, you have to keep in your mind that I am observing this event for collecting data. Now, advantages of participant observation. Firstly, acquire information that is true and extensive, because you are actually participating in any event, so you will have a vast knowledge about any topic. Observe natural behavior, because in uncontrolled observation, natural environment is not destroyed and you will have greater insights into various phenomena which people otherwise not tell you. Now, limitations of participant observation. Firstly, time is a limiting factor, because any researchers have to spend a lot of time in earlier days so that those people become very comfortable with that scholar. So it is very time costly. Now, observes biasness or emotional attachment with the community or their events, that will reduce objectivity, and all the phenomena or behavior are not subject to observation. For example, outside males are not allowed to observe any pregnancy related rituals. So you can quote these common examples. Now, maintain objectivity of research is highly difficult, and it is not conducive to collect historical data because you are observing present society. So how you can collect historical data, that is another question mark. Now, resources like time, money, these are very limiting, because high investment of time and money make this approach very costly. Now, non-participant observation. So we have started with uncontrolled observation. First was participant observation, second is non-participant observation. So here, conducted in observation where any scholar will not actually participate in the group activities, although that individual will be present in any ritual or event, but here scholar is not actively participating in activities of the group. Here objectivity and neutrality can be maintained because close participant observation is absent, and by keeping a distance from the group, it is easier for any scholar to maintain objectivity and reduce biasness. But there are demerits of non-participant observation as well. Firstly, dangers of subjectivity are high, because if any individual is observing any event, he will observe from his mentality, his attitude, and also from his school of thought, because anthropologists have different school of thought, and if any scholar has a belief in one type of school, then he will try to justify his school by giving examples from that research. So you can mention this also, as the group might feel uncomfortable because now scholar is not an active member of that community. Now nobody would like to open their true feelings, actions, attitude and opinion before a stranger. So it will be very difficult for any stranger to actually collect data about very sensitive issues. And in extreme case, it is also possible that non-participant observation will be looked by a suspicion, because if any society is enjoying their ritual but any stranger is observing them, it becomes uncomfortable for any community or any individual. Even you can relate with your life, real life example, when someone is observing you continuously, individuals automatically become uncomfortable. Now, controlled observation, we have discussed about uncontrolled observation by discussing participant as well as non-participant method. Now is controlled observation. So in this type, an attempt is made to exercise control over the phenomena of observation. That means here observation will be done in a controlled environment. Here external factors are controlled, and this will work according to a pre-planned manner. And here it is possible that objective study can be done and biasness will be low. Here some controlled or external factors also include some regulated activities of observer as well, because here observer will be given certain guidance that you have to observe all these parameters and you have to follow this particular method. That means here individuals' variations or individuals' biasness of any researcher will be reduced, and which will be higher in participant observation or uncontrolled observation. So this method increase precision, reliability and objectivity of any researcher. So that's all for today. We will discuss remaining topic in next class. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. Please like, share and subscribe TaskIS. Thank you.